Hello all, welcome back to Vajja Online Teaching. This is our session 3 on the topic Biological Classification, which comes under Class 11, Chapter 2. And today we are discussing about the kingdom Protista. So, kingdom Protista. Kingdom Protista consists of all the single-celled eukaryotes. So, the members of the Monera, kingdom Monera, were all prokaryotes or organisms which are having primitive nucleus, but when coming to kingdom Protista, all the members of kingdom Protista are unicellular or single cell, but all of them are eukaryotes. They possesses a true nucleus with proper nuclear membrane and all. Okay, and the term Protista is derived from the Greek word protistos, and the meaning of protistos is very first, the very first. Why? Because these organisms are considered as the first evolved eukaryotic organisms, and studies show that they evolved almost 1.5 billion years ago. Okay, and now where do this protista members are found? They are mostly they are aquatic, and they are present in the soil or in areas with moisture. Okay, and this kingdom forms a link between plants, animals and fungi. Okay. And there are some members of Protista which have similarity to plants. Some members have more similarity towards animals, and some show similarity towards fungi also. So this kingdom is considered as a connecting link between kingdom Plantae, kingdom Animalia and kingdom Fungi. Okay. As we said, they all of them are eukaryotes. They are having a true well-defined nucleus with proper nuclear membrane and all the membrane-bound organelles like chloroplast, mitochondria, lysosome, etc. Okay, and some have flagella or cilia. They are the locomotory organs. They help in locomotion and movement. Flagella and cilia are the structures for locomotion, and they can be autotrophic or heterotrophic depending upon what are they like, whether they are similar to plants or animals, whether they possess chloroplast pigment or something. They can be autotrophic, they can prepare their own food, and they can be heterotrophic also. They show similarity to fungi. So some have saprophytic mode of nutrition, some depends on other organisms, some are parasites like that. Their mode of nutrition depends on which organism or which species they are. Okay. And in some members, symbiosis is also observed. That means they live in mutual association with some other organisms. And parasitism is also observed in members of Protista. And they show both sexual method of reproduction also, asexual method of reproduction. But the most common is asexual method of reproduction only. And the sexual method of reproduction occurs only during times of stress. And the different methods of sexual reproduction are cell fusion and by zygote formation. So, these are the basic features of the members of kingdom Protista. Moving on, as we said, they are considered as the connecting link between animals, plants and fungi. So, based on that, they are divided into three main groups. There are some Protista members which show animal-like properties, and they are called as animal-like protist, also called protozoa. Almost all of them are heterotrophic. And the meaning of protozoa is first animal. Proto, first, zoa, something related to animal. So, animal like protista are the first, considered as the first animals. And all of them are heterotrophs. And the second category is plant-like protist, algae. They have similarity towards the plant. And almost all of them have chlorophyll pigment or chloroplast they have. And they can do photosynthesis. So, almost all of them are autotrophic. They prepare their own food. And the fungus-like protist, they are mostly saprophytes, decomposers and all, and they are also heterotrophs. They cannot prepare their own food. So, we'll study in detail each of the classes or each of the groups. And the first group is plant-like protist, algae. Okay. And the first example is chrysophytes. Chrysophytes include diatoms and golden algae. Golden algae is called as desmids. And almost their habitat is they are found in water, either fresh water or in marine environments they are found. They are all microscopic and they they float passively on the water current. So they are called as phytoplanktons. Okay. They are called as planktons. They look like a plant floating on the surface of the water. So they are called as planktons. And this diatoms, we know that diatoms, rich deposits of diatoms are there, and that is known as diatomaceous earth. Okay. and most of them are photosynthetic. They process chloroplast, so they can do photosynthesis. They contain chlorophyll, and the other pigments are carotenoids and xanthophylls are also present in this members, chrysophytes. Examples, diatoms and desmids, or the golden algae. And this diagram is showing the like a plankton kind of floaty sticking to algae, just like algae only on the water surface. So this is the first category. And the second one is dinoflagellate. Dinoflagellate, the name itself suggests that they have two flagellas. Okay, and all of them are unicellular, single-celled, eukaryotic. They possess true nucleus, well-defined membrane-bound organelles. Everything is there. But why they are called dinoflagellates is that they possess two whip-like tails called as flagella, and the function of the flagella is for movement. Okay, and their habitat is marine and freshwater environment. They are found, and they are photosynthetic. They are differently colored depending upon the pigments present on them. Their color varies. There are yellow dinoflagellates, green, brown, blue, and red. Okay, and they all possess very thick cell wall, which is made up of cellulose. And this red dinoflagellates, one example is goniolects, and they undergo rapid multiplication, and they are found in seas usually, and because of their presence in sea, the sea water appears as blue. Sorry, red. Okay, it appears as red, and that is known as red tide. And this Red Sea is an example for that. It is due to the presence of this particular dinoflagellate, which is red in color. Okay, it's a Red Sea. The second diagram is showing the Red Sea, and this is that dino means that organism with the red pigment in them. And they undergo rapid multiplication, and it's spread so randomly that the entire surface of the sea will appear as red. Okay, and they also release some toxins, and it is even capable of killing marine animals such as fishes and all. And this is the dinoflagellate with the two flagella, and that's it. Okay, now the third organism that we are studying is euglenoids. Okay, euglenoids are protists which show characters both of plants and animals, and they are all unicellular. They also have two flagella, but one flagella is very short and one flagella is very long in euglena. And majority of them are freshwater organism, and usually they are found in stagnant water. And instead of cell wall, they have a proteinaceous covering around the plasma membrane, or around the cell membrane there is another cell wall. It is not made up of cell wall as like in algae and all. It is made up of another protein rich covering called as pellicle. Okay, and their body is very much flexible because of this pellicle, and they are all photosynthetic. They contain chloroplast, and but some members of these euglenoid group are predators and heterotrophic also. And this is the structure of the euglena, a member of euglenoid group. It contains cytoplasm, all the cell organelles. It has a mitochondria, nucleus, nuclear membrane, nucleoid, chloroplast, and it has a flagellum, one big flagellum, and contractile vacuole is there. And it has a photoreceptor. It can detect like sense light, and it has an eye spot also. This is about euglenoids. So this is a category of protista which has similarities both towards kingdom plantae and kingdom animalia, and they are also single-celled organism. They are mostly live in waters, freshwater organisms they are, and they have two flagellas. One flagella is very long and one flagella is short, and they have cell wall which is made up of pellicle, and pellicle is making them more flexible. Their body is more flexible because of the presence of protein covering called as pellicle. They possess chloroplast, so they can do photosynthesis. They are autotrophic, but some members of this group are heterotrophic also. They live as predators. So that is the third category of protists. Now coming to the fourth group of protists, slime mounds. Okay, and the slime mounds are actually entirely different from the other members of the protista. They have their own special features and all. And when we speak about the drawbacks of the five kingdom classification, the positioning of or the presence of slime mounds in kingdom protista is like a sort of confusion. But still, they are a particular group in kingdom protista with their own peculiar properties, and we'll discuss about what the characteristics of slime moulds are. Slime moulds are saprophytic protists. They feed on dead and decaying organic matter. Under suitable conditions, they form aggregations called as plasmodium. Many slime moulds together, they form aggregations, and that is known as plasmodium. And this happens under their favorable conditions. And during unfavorable condition, this plasmodium gets differentiated and forms spore-like structures, or it forms a sporangia kind of a structure with spores inside them. Okay, just like spores are just like something like a this pollen grain, and they fall off and they give rise to the new organism like that. This plasmodium is an aggregation of slime moulds under favorable conditions, and when their environment is stressful, they undergo a differentiation and form a sporangia kind of a structure wearing spores at the tip. Okay, and the spores are dispersed by air currents. And speaking about the spores has true walls. They are extremely resistant and they can survive for many years also. And whenever the favorable condition comes, it can survive over long time also. And when favorable conditions return, they again germinate and form slime moulds and form aggregations like plasmodium and all. Okay, and the plasmodium of a slime mould is formed from the fusion of mixed amoeba or swarm cells. Okay, this mixed amoeba or swarm cells are actually the gametes produced, gamete kind of a structure produced by the slime moulds, and two gametes fuses and produces this plasmodium. Okay. And the mixed amoebae are spores released from slime moulds, and it possesses pseudopodia. The name mixed amoebae they got because they possess pseudopodia, locomotory organ similar to that found in amoeba. Because of their amoeba-like appearance and behavior only, they are called as mixed amoebae. Mixed amoeba are actually spores released from the sporangia kind of a structure in the slime moulds. Okay, and the spores, these are formed by the fusion of the gametes, or it's also called as swarm cells. And they are plasmodia are usually shapeless, and they possess pseudopodia, so they are able to move, and they can able to like they are moved by the air currents, and that is how it's getting dispersed, and the germination takes place when favorable conditions return. And this is the life cycle of the slime mold, plasmodial slime mold life cycle. Okay, so this is spores. They produce spores, haploid spores. So this is the slime mold. See, this diagram shows this is slime mold. A mature, they occur in groups, okay, and the groups of slime molds are called as plasmodium, and a mature plasmodium undergoes some differentiation, and it produces a sporangia. Inside that spores are there, and this diagram shows the sporangia. This is a sporangia, a bag like sac like cup like structure with a stalk attached to the surface, and it has spores. And meiosis happens in the spores, and it produces haploid spores. And the spores are getting dispersed by air currents because they have pseudopodia for movement. And germination gives rise to cells that convert between amoeboid and flagellate forms. Some of the spores germinating cells are amoeboid with pseudopodia, and some are euglenoid flagellated, just like the other members. They are flagellated. Okay. And they fuse together and form zygote, and the zygote undergo mitosis, that means equational division, and result in the formation of the slime mold adult organism. And again, they aggregate together and form plasmodium, and the whole process continues. And this is the life cycle of the slime molds. This is why they are entirely different from the other groups. They have amoeboid like properties also. They have flagellated euglena like property also, and they are like formed in aggregates. So they are entirely different from the other members of this group, this kingdom. So that's their peculiarity. Now moving to the fifth group, it's protozoans, primitive animals. They are entirely animal like protists. Okay, they are considered to be the first animal like organisms, and they are all heterotrophs. They either live as predators or they live as parasites on other organisms. And these protozoans are again classified into four major groups, and the criteria used for this classification is how they move or what is their locomotory organ. Based on that, the protozoans are divided into four different classes or four different groups. And the first group is amoeboid protozoans, which look like amoeba or which has pseudopodia like amoeba, or the locomotory organ in those group of protozoan is pseudopodia, which is a feature of amoeba. Okay, so amoeboids, that is the first category of protozoans. And the second category is ciliates. Okay, they possess cilia, small hair-like projections all over the body, just like what paramecium and all are having. And that group of protozoans are called as ciliates. And the third one is sporozoa. Sporozoa members are non-motile protozoans. Okay, they are animal-like. They are animal-like protist only, but they doesn't have any flagella, any cilia, any pseudopodia. They are non-motile. And the fourth group is flagellates. Flagellate protozoans are having flagella for the locomotion. Okay, so these are the four categories of protozoa based on the organ that is helping them for moving or locomotory organ. They are classified into four groups: amoeboid, amoeba, ciliates, paramecium, sporozoa, a non-motile organism, flagellates, flagella, or euglena, and all are examples of flagellates. So this is the four category of protozoans. Okay. Now in detail we'll see what are the features of these four groups. So first one is amoeboid protozoans. Amoeboid protozoans are all living in fresh water or sea water, or moist. They live in water, moist environments, and they move and capture their prey, food and extra by using some structures known as pseudopodia. Pseudopodia is pseudopodia, that means false feet. It is a feature of amoeba. Okay, amoeba has pseudopodia for capturing its prey and all. So amoeboid protozoan possesses a pseudopodia. And the members of amoeboid protozoans, which are marine, they have a silica shell all over their surface. And some members like entamoeba and all, they are parasites also. They feed on other organisms. Okay, these are the features of the amoeboid protozoans. Now coming to the second category, it's flagellated protozoan. Protozoan, animal-like protist only with flagella as the organ for locomotion. And almost all the members of this group are either parasitic or free living. They possess flagella, that is why they come under this category. Then parasitic forms are disease causing. They causes certain diseases like sleeping sickness and all. And an example of flagellated protozoan is Trypanosoma. Now ciliated protozoan, the paramecium is an example of ciliated protozoan. Cilia, small hair-like structure, very very small. But cilia, when comparing between cilia and flagella, both are hair-like projections only. But cilia is small and its number will be more. It will be through the entire surface of the body, number will be more. But flagella, it will be long and the number will be less, either on one side or on two sides, something like that. Okay. And now the ciliated protozoans are aquatic and they are actively moving organism because of the presence of many cilia on their entire body surface. Okay, they have a body cavity called as gullet and it opens to the outside of the cell surface. And all cilia, the millions of cilia on their body or thousands of cilia on their bodies, are their movement is in a coordinated way. Okay, it's like not each and every cilia are moving its own way. It's not like that. There is a coordinated movement of cilia, that is how they are able to move. The entire organism is able to move, and it causes the water laden with food to be steered into the gullet. That means its food will be present in some place in the water, and the organism is identifying the food, and it will move its cilia in a coordinated way so that it is able to catch up this food into the body cavity. That's how it's feeding. Okay, and the example is paramecium. And the fourth category of protists are sporozoans, and they include diverse organisms which are almost infectious in nature. They all of them have an infectious spore-like stage in their life cycle, and that at that point of time it will it may be like infecting an organism, or it may be going to a vector, and the vector when go and bite up a organism, the organism will get disease. Example, malarial parasite and all, like this malarial parasite is called as Plasmodium. Plasmodium is an example of an organism which comes under this category. Their spore stage is the infectious stage. That that is they are called as sporozoans. Okay, and this malarial parasite and all are it's like causing malarial disease in humans. Okay, so they are infectious. There are spore stages, infectious stage. So these are the four categories of protozoans. And to wind up, we can say that the protozoans are, some are animal-like, some are fungi-like saprophytes, some are plant-like or autotrophic also, processes different kinds of pigments and all, algae, diatom, etc. Slime molds comes under this group. So these are the primitive organs, but they are eukaryotes. That is the main, most important category, most important feature of this category or this kingdom Protista when compared to the kingdom Munira. All the members of the kingdom Munira were prokaryotes, but when coming to Protista, all the members are eukaryotes. They have a true nucleus. They have a true nucleus with a nuclear membrane, and they have all the membrane-bound organelles, a proper cell membrane. Even the plant-like members are having cell wall also. It can be either made of cellulose or with a protein covering, depending upon the organism. They have special locomotory structures, either cilia or flagella, or they have pseudopodia-like structure and all. And the one peculiar member of this group is slime molds. The positioning of the slime molds in this category is a question of confusion, but still they are in this group. And the slime molds are having a plasmodial stage. It is as having a special method of its life cycle, and that's about protozoans. Okay, and protozoans are considered as the first animal-like organisms. Okay, yeah, this is about kingdom Protista, and in the next class we will be studying about kingdom fungi. Thank you.